to another Unwinding with Fiber and Fabric. It has been a very, very busy number of days since I last made my vlog. My husband and I have changed out the flooring in our TV room. I like the British term, a snug. It's a tiny little room that I think may have been originally designed as a dining room or an office, but compact size. And it makes a really good TV room for the two of us. Yes, push comes to shove, we could have one or two other people sit nearby, but let me get adjusted here. But for us, it's a tiny little room, so it wasn't a lot of flooring that had to be changed out, but it has made a huge difference. We have a house that originally had hardwood floors, but the original owners clearly took out portions of the hardwood floors due to some unforeseen issues over the years. And while we'd love to have hardwood floors all through the house, there are a couple rooms that just don't work anything other than carpet. So we've done the best we can to make this house comfortable and easy for me to maintain. And as any of you that are spinners know, and I'm sure the cat owners understand, probably the dog owners as well, and probably anybody who does use a lot of wool, keeping the dust bunnies down, keeping the fiber from attaching itself to everywhere, it can be a bit of a challenge. So anything that we have that is, that can make it a little easier, like a hardwood floor as opposed to wall-to-wall carpet, it helps. Because I tell you, after having done the floors and we painted that room, it was the last room that really hadn't been painted since we moved in, we decided to shampoo the remaining carpet, and we vigorously vacuumed, but we still had a great deal of fiber that came up with the wet vac. I think primarily fiber that comes from our cat, Callie, otherwise known as Kitty Putty. So let's start this Unwinding with Fiber and Fabric, talking about how to take care of the fiber producer in your house, the cat. But on to the rest of the stuff. I do have some finished objects I want to share with you. And yeah, it's mostly finished objects, as well as two projects that I am working on currently. And so let's just go ahead and dive in. For those of you that have been watching regularly, you'll know that I had a unplanned fiber scouring day and an oops spin that arrived from that. Well, I knitted up into one of my muffin top hats. And you can see the different colors from my oops fiber. Just a very simple. And I wanted to just talk quickly about this hat. I do have a pattern for it available on my blog. It's probably now been a while since I posted it. If you go on my blog and you go under Dust Bunnies and Other Things, I think is one of the categories, that kind of this will come up. There's also Patterns to Download as one of the categories. And you can scroll through and find my muffin top hat. If I've made the pattern available as opposed to just showing a picture. But I just wanted to talk about it. It's a simple hat, and by all means, feel free to play around with it if you'd like. All I do is cast on a number of stitches that, it's important, divisible by four, but that goes around the circumference of my head. My gauge is really, really loose, so oftentimes my hats are not as tight as they should be, but I use the same cable each time rather than trying to figure out an exact number because the gauge of the yarn changes, especially when I'm using hand spun. And so all I do is cast on the number of stitches that I need to go around the circumference of my head or the head of the person I'm making it for. It needs to be divisible by 4 because I'm doing a 2x2 rib. And then you start the knitting. I start off by doing enough. In most cases, if I have a lot of yarn, I start off by doing enough ribbing to be able to do, as you just saw, the fold back band. If you don't want a fold back band, it works fine the other way. But what I then do is once I have the ribbing done, I do one round that's just a plain knit. And then I have 2 options that I choose from there. If I'm making this and I want it really floppy, especially for women, or if it's a really fun fiber and I want a really floppy hat, it doesn't matter if it's for women or if it's for men, I will increase in the next round, I will increase every other stitch. Now, that puts a pile of stitches on the needles and it can be a little bit of a stretch, but I do every other stitch and then I knit until it reaches the crown of my head. If I'm doing this and I want it like this one, a little less poofy, then I will do an increase in every 4th stitch all the way around. And what that does is I'll roll the brim back up again. It creates a bit of the poof, a bit of a tam or beret type style. Okay. But not overblown. And then, as I said, I just knit until I reach the crown. Once I know I have at least got to the crown or a little bit beyond, then I put in markers to do the decrease. And you'll see the spokes. I find that if I have completely gone past the crown, really big, humongous, especially if I've done the increases every other stitch, the more markers, the faster the decrease. Less markers, the slower the decrease. And then you have a choice of either decreasing before each marker or before and after each marker to go faster. In this case, I decreased before and after each marker to get that done because I was going for a less poofy hat and it worked. So again, simple vanilla hat. It's my muffin top. And if you're looking for a way to use your hand spun or remnant skeins, orphan skeins, this is a really great hat. And it is wonderful with a matching cowl. Whoops, sorry to touch the mic. A matching cowl works just as well. Again, same in this case, same number of stitches, and then just stop when you're done. So that is my first finished object. My second finished object is, yes, my gray capelet. And you might be able to see how fuzzy it is, and then it's not as fuzzy. The angora has bloomed beautifully. I'll pull it up here so you can see the bottom. In this case, I forgot to do, I normally do like a seed stitch on the last couple rows. Totally forgot. But what I did do is I bound off doing a US style half double crochet, okay? And it gave really nice defined eyelets as opposed to with a double crochet, you would have very loose stitches or spokes of the crochet. But having that half double crochet, and it eludes me at the moment what the British term for that is, so you'll have to search it. But half double crochet gave a wonderful kind of eyelet finish, which I think looks really well with these spokes. And of course, again, I had the angora mixed in, which is why the bottom has such a heavier look, a denser look, and a fuzzy, as well as it shifts the color from this. So, absolutely love it. It's another one finished. It's a smaller size, but It is a wonderful size for sitting and reading because it ends at my elbows, so it keeps my shoulders and my upper arms warm, but it doesn't interfere with my hands. So I'm very, very pleased with that finished object. So the next thing I have is a project that I have started on my needles. And yes, you can guess, it's another capelet. This is some yarn that I guess you could say it's kind of like a garage sale. Somebody's fiber destashing. I have to be careful because I am going to pull. I should know better. I know that I've reached a point where I need to go with a larger needle. Let me go ahead and just catch that on because I just pulled the needle off and I know I've just dropped. Well, I haven't dropped two stitches. I've just messed up two stitches. So I will have to be fixing this here in just a bit. But I wanted to share that. It was somebody's a destash. It is merino and cashmere. The teal is the same type. I've put some very, very fluffy, very blooming bunny in with the teal. I think it really blends the colors much better than having a harsh line. And I have a bunch of this, so I think this is going to be another one of the very large capes rather than a tiny capelet. It is luscious. It is wonderful. I'm thrilled to get another one started. It's nice to have something that is just easy and relaxing to knit with. I went down to a size. I have a size 3. I have some 60 inch cables that have just arrived. I'll be switching those on to very soon. So of course I have another one of those going. And that brings me, and that project is fabulous because as I told you in the last video, I've started going to a knitting group. That one is wonderful because I can knit and I can chat and just relax. But since I last spoke to you, I joined a second knitting group. I got everything put together and I went out and checked out one of my local yarn stores on a national local yarn store day. And so it was a yarn store I meant to check out 3 years ago. I had it on my calendar to go to one of their sit and spins just as everybody started going into lockdown. And yes, it's taken me 3 years and a lot of effort to get to the point where I felt like, okay, I could go out and try again. I went into the local yarn store. I have a picture I will share. I asked everybody if I could take a picture and share it. It is called the Knitting Coop. And I walked in and I immediately felt comfortable. So I'm going to explain really quickly why this specific yarn store made me feel comfortable for any of those of you that may have a bit of a struggle, or if you have a yarn store and you're trying to figure out a way to make people like me with a little bit of anxiety feel more comfortable. The owner of this store said she really had spent years gathering her ideas together to try to have a comfortable social gathering place rather than just a store. And she was able to find a shop. It's really interesting because in the United States, we don't have a lot of main streets, old buildings that have retained their original layout. But I know that in the UK, you have a lot of older buildings that have the long, narrow store shop. Okay, not a wide front, but long in the back. Well, she had the opportunity to move into a location that has two available next to each other, long, narrow store locations. And they're connected, but they're still separate. So walking into her store, the one side is the shop. It's where you do your shopping. And the second side is the social gathering with its own entrance and exit, even though it is connected and you can go through and it's open and it feels open. And that's the thing. As someone who pays attention to these things, it is clear that because her shop is in the one area and her social area is in the second area, it makes it so she can watch her shop and her customers can feel comfortable socializing without feeling as if they are under constant surveillance. And for somebody with anxiety, that is huge, because I fully understand why the shop owner needs to survey their shop. But because I am so aware of that, it makes me always feel like I don't want to look like I'm doing something wrong. And that's one of the things with anxiety, is it's not rational. There's no rational to it. And so on the social side, she's just made it. It's like a dining room and living room all combined together. It's a wonderful space. It has good chairs that can really, wide bottom chairs that can, that can encompass our girth if we are in that stage of life. And yet we can feel included. We can feel part of it. We can feel the vibe and the energy. But we also don't have to worry about being surrounded by stuff that is being sold for our own comfort, as well as for the comfort of the shop owner. It's huge. For me, I walked in and I immediately knew this was somewhere that I was going to be able to feel comfortable. And I did. So I took the plunge and I bought some yarn. And now I don't tend to buy yarn. I spin yarn. I look for de-stashes at best. You know, I'll go to festivals, but I really don't buy yarn. But when I do buy yarn, I want to spend my money on stuff that's going to make my hands feel okay. I want it to be something that I'm going to cherish. In short, I have enough in my stash that has been given to me over the years of the stuff that is great utility, teaching tools, all of that. If I'm going to buy yarn for myself, I'm going to buy really nice yarn. So I did. So she's doing a block a month, and this is the January block, and it's blocks that she has just created the pattern repeats so that we could make basically a 9.5-10 inch square that we can stitch together to make an afghan. And she had some wonderful yarn for the project. A huge wall, every color imaginable, and a really good price point for everyone's budget. However, it's hard on my hands. My hands get tired. My hands get sensitive. I get sensitive. And again, as wonderful as all was, I knew it would not give me the extreme. It might give me joy, but it wouldn't give me extreme joy. But this 100% baby alpaca yarn, it gives me extreme joy. And yes, I'm making this for me. And for those of you that follow me know, I don't do patterns. And I'm doing a block of the month that's all patterns. And that's the other reason I was looking for extreme joy. If it gives me extreme joy, I will do it. I will make myself do it. So I bought all the yarn I needed for all 12 months. Plus, based on how this one turned out, I think I'm going to have a few remnants, so I might actually have a year and a half worth. But it's lovely. It's easy on my hands. It encourages me. It makes me want to figure it out. And so I wanted to share that, because with the U.S. holiday of Mother's Day coming up just in a week or so, I guess a week, this is my Mother's Day gift. My husband, my children, they're like, yes, Mom. totally that is a Mother's Day gift, because it's not just the yarn, but my mother taught herself how to knit making squares like this when I was only just a tiny little toddler, maybe just barely out of diapers, if that. And that's how she taught herself to knit. And that legacy of her knitting has been so important in my life, in my children's lives, in the people that she knew's life, their lives. And so that drew me in, that idea of maybe it's time for me to take another leap and face this part, because I know a lot of the history of when my mom taught herself how to knit. I know a lot of the good things and the tough things of that period of her life. And those squares that she made, she never stitched them together. I still have them. She has been gone now for 15 years, and I still haven't stitched them together. And those squares are now, oh my goodness, they're like 50 years old. And one of the reasons I haven't done anything with them is that the ones she made 50 years ago, they're made out of wool. But there was another tough time in her life in which she decided to go back to them. And that was about 40 years ago. And she used acrylic and she made a couple of squares out of that. And for me, when I see all those squares, I am so conscious, I'm so aware of what the story is. So for me, the idea of this, feeling inspired to do this, feeling the prompting to go and try being in the store, stepping out of my comfort zone, stepping into something new, it's connected. And now is the time to finish that connection, get past it, go into the future, embrace something new, and let the past be the past. So, I think baby alpaca, which by the way, I had my sunglasses on, which I can read with my sunglasses. They are polarized. They are prescription, but they do not show me color well. So I had them up on the top of my head when I was looking at the yarn and squinting to see what the fiber content of the yarn was. I saw the image of an alpaca on it. So I knew it was alpaca. Okay, didn't know what the content was other than that. It wasn't until I got home and was working on this January square, because I was working on the April square in the store. It wasn't until I got home and was working on the January square that I looked at the fiber content and saw that it was baby alpaca. 100%. And I was like, well, it'll have drape if nothing else. It's definitely a treat. And I have a feeling that this Afghan for me will be just that. Not that I need more Afghans. I have Afghans. I have quilts. But it'll be a treat for me. So that's one of the projects I'm doing. So what I'm doing is, when I go to the one group, I'm going to take my easy, just chat project. When I go to the other group, which I can go and sit and knit any Saturday. Actually, there's the store has multiple days that you can do that. For me, Saturday morning is perfect. So I'm going to have a Thursday midday group and a Saturday morning group, and once a month I'll get a new pattern to try. But I'm going to get caught up. I'm going to make these. I'm going to use this yarn. I'm going to stitch it together, and I'm going to embrace the challenge of once a week at least figuring out the pattern. And I will tell you this one. So this was she said it was a reverse seed rib. And I know it doesn't show up as well on the thing, but I'll just show. Oh, first of all, it wasn't as difficult as I thought it was going to be for my brain to follow it. Second of all, I love it. I absolutely love it as a texture, as a way to end a project, way to have it. I love it. I really, absolutely love the way it feels. And that is the big thing. If you like the way it feels, if it's giving you joy, then you will make the foggy brain follow the pattern. And that's what happened. So yeah, I'm really encouraged. I'm really excited to have this. And I'm very grateful for all of the local yarn stores out there who try so hard to bring us these things that we may not actually ever try to do. They inspire us. I know that this, I'm sure, was somebody being inspired in a local yarn store. I have Angora now on my face. We don't always manage to finish all of our Inspire projects. We sometimes don't even get a chance to start our Inspired projects. But that inspiration in its own right makes the journey worth it. Being inspired to try something new, being inspired to go out and do something new, get out of our comfort zone. That is the journey. That is part of the journey. That is the value. It's not the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. It's the rainbow itself. The journey. That is what we need to be seeking. Because if we find ourselves embracing the journey, then we already have the goal, don't we? So, speaking of journeys, before I wrap this video up, I have two more finished objects to share with you of the quilting variety. The first one is a project that I was sharing a lot of photos on Instagram with back in January and February. The designs are by Creative Kiwi. They are made with machine embroidery. I had a ton of fun, but I couldn't finish it until I hand quilted it. And it's a heavy, heavy quilt because I made sure that each of the appliques actually had great stability under it. When I washed the stabilizer away, there was still stability because each of the appliques had a muslin piece underneath it, as well as batting. So it's poofy, it's stable, and it needed to be quilted around each of those heavy pieces so that they would lay flat when I threw it in the washing machine. And I hoped I had quilted and tacked it down enough places, and it did. It held up. Because one of the things that happens when you wash a quilt that has a lot of cotton in the batting, a lot of cotton in the fibers, is it can shrink. And I like that it does that. I like that used, crinkly look. However, it needs to be stable. So I had to spend a lot of time working around all those pieces, stitching them all down. I stitched all of the appliques on by machine, and then I hand quilted the sandwich together. So that's the first of my finished objects. But let's wrap up going back to that journey that sometimes takes a while. And we'll look at what I have and I may have shown a picture of this months ago after putting it together. I can't remember now. But it is my sampler pack quilt that I put together a bunch of blocks now over 10 years ago. 10 years ago? No. Over 10 years ago. About 13 years ago, I started putting together these blocks. And I had put them together using scraps of fabric, donated to me fabric that wasn't the prettiest in my mind. And I wanted to have one that actually looked like the pattern that I had created on paper. So this is my sampler pack not scrap, sampler, in the name, sampler pack sampler quilt. There we go. My sampler pack sample quilt. And I'm thrilled with the way it turned out, the way it looks, it fits on the wall. I need a little bit longer hanging rod for it, but it brings me happy. It makes me, you know, very filled with joy. I think it looks, for me, it's a really good spring, summer, definitely summer type quilt. I like the fact that it is reminiscent of the red, white, and blue patriotism that many of our countries share, but it's not red, white, and blue. And that, to me, makes it all the intensity of what the red, white, and blue, but with more warmth and less of the negatives that sometimes come from being overly zealous in our flag waving. I believe that we can be very patriotic, but we don't need to be in people's faces. And I think the quilt does it. It gives me something that gives that feel. When I made a patriotic type quilt that was the quilt of valor for my husband, which he ended up thinking my son should have instead, and my son thought that the quilt that I made for him should be for my husband, and they swapped. When I did that specific quilt, I also moved away from the traditional red, white, and blue because it is actually a cream instead of white. And again, it feels more like something that embraces rather than something that can oftentimes repel. So it's been a journey putting it together. It's been a journey getting it quilted. And I guess this is the real moral of the message today. Things happen when they're supposed to happen, whether it's good or bad, whether it is something that makes you smile or makes you very sad. Things happen when they're supposed to happen. And if I had finished that quilt, I think before now, I might not have loved it as much. When I first started creating it, I really loved what I was doing. When I started creating the patterns, I loved what I was doing. But putting the quilt together and making the quilt and having it to be something that I shared, I had lost the joy. And now when I get it done and I hang it on the wall all these years later, the things that had caused me to not have the joy, those are gone. They're again in the past. They've been resolved, not buried, not pushed aside, but resolved. And so, if we even just look at a block and how me following a pattern after all these years on a regular basis, the challenge of it, the resolve of it, that's the gift. That's the gold. That's the precious of the journey. So wherever you're at in your projects, in your day, in your life, I hope you can find the joy so that you can find the precious moments of the journey, the precious rewards of the journey. Well, I'm going to end this video. There will probably be, I should say, I'm wearing a top that I made. I will show a little footage of that. As I have mentioned in my past video, I wanted to have tops that I could wear with a bra, or as you will see, without a bra, so that I could be comfortable and so that on my bad days, I don't have to have the constriction that does end up starting to cause me pain. So I wanted to share that with you. I'll end this video with just a short clip, and it will probably be very short. a short clip of me spinning some additional Angora for this project. So I hope you have enjoyed unwinding with fiber and fabric with me today. I wish you the best. And for all of you that are out there celebrating, I wish you the best, if it is something you celebrate, Coronation Day. Yes, this video will be posted probably right after all of that hits British TV. Be assured, I am going to be awake watching, because for me, wherever you stand on the topic, celebration in a time of strife can help us feel connected and feel like life is not as difficult as we sometimes think. Pageantry, celebration, festivals, all of these things are important in our lives. And we should celebrate. Maybe it's not something that resonates with us, but we should celebrate that it resonates with someone. If it is a positive, that if it is something that is a positive, trying to do something that helps, trying to do something that gives back, trying to do something that shares, trying to do something that uplifts, that creates joy. We should celebrate that others are celebrating it. We should embrace that. We should wrap our arms around it and say, good, good for you. We're behind you. We need to support each other rather than always criticize each other. There's a time and a place for debate and a time and a place for criticism, critical review. But we also need to celebrate when it is a time to celebrate. So happy Coronation Day as this goes out for those of you that are celebrating or just watching the pageantry from afar. I will see you again in a couple weeks. Until then, find some time to unwind with fiber and fabric. And if nothing else, find some time to laugh. We'll see you soon.